Hi, everyone. Hi. Today, I'm so excited to be going live with a special guest, an old friend, Kyera Singleton, who's the executive director of Royall House 1737 on Instagram. We're going to be having a really powerful conversation today, so come on in. And Kyera will be joining me in a second. Hi.
Hi.
How are you?
Hi, how are you doing?
I'm good. How are you?
Doing well. Just, you know, excited to have this conversation with you.
Awesome. So I just want to introduce you and introduce what we're going to be talking about today.
Okay.
So Kyera Singleton is an old friend of mine, but is also the executive director of an incredible museum in Boston. And today we're going to be talking about the work of this museum to memorialize the history of slavery. And it's part of a benefit for a reconstruction project that they're doing there to maintain the historical records and the historical site there. They're trying to raise $20,000. We're at 15.7, I think.
Yes.
And we've got donation links in the museum's bio and in my bio. So after watching the conversation, please, or even during the conversation, check that out to learn more. So if we could begin, can you tell us a little bit about yourself and the Royall House?
Yeah. So my name is Kyera Singleton, as Alok mentioned, and I am the executive director of the Royall House in Slave Quarters. It's a historical museum in Medford, Massachusetts, which is right outside of Boston. A little bit about me. I am a PhD candidate in American Studies at the University of Michigan, and I've been actually in the Boston area for the last year as a visiting fellow in Harvard's history department, and now I'm working at the Royall House in Slave Quarters. And I do work on slavery and incarceration in the 19th century.
Okay, so this is gonna be a really powerful conversation. We've got an expert in the house. We're gonna be talking about histories of slavery, racism, the importance of museum culture. And please, while we're having this conversation, check out Royall House's Instagram to see the GoFundMe. So let's just get into it. One of the misconceptions that a lot of people have about the history of slavery is that slavery just occurred in the U.S. South and that it wasn't happening in the U.S. North. I've heard and reading about this museum, this is one of the last historical sites in New England. Can you speak to the importance of maintaining a site in New England and also comment on the legacies of slavery within the U.S. North?
Yeah, that's a great question. So one of the things that we've been working on is really kind of like, you know, to debunk this myth that, you know, slavery happened in the South, right? And the North is just about abolition. You know, you get the very powerful abolitionist history when it comes to New England in particular, and people do not necessarily want to talk about slavery. But one of the things that we really stress is that when you think about slavery, you have to think about it in a local sense, a regional sense, and a global sense. And the interesting thing about New England is that when we're thinking about the West Indies and sugarcane production and sugar plantations, a lot of the ships are actually coming through Boston. A lot of enslaved people are, you know, being transported from the West Indies through the ports in New England and transported down south, right? So it's all connected. And I think that that's one of the hardest misconceptions to really kind of work with, because people say, well, in Massachusetts, slavery was actually outlawed very early. But when you actually look at the history starting from, you know, the 17th century, you have enslaved people fighting and pushing against the Massachusetts legislature to get freedom, right? To define freedom on their own terms. And so I think that there's an interesting point here, which is also to think about when you think of the South, one of the things you think of in particular is 19th century. And mm-hmm. we're in the 18th century, we're a revolutionary era. And I think that that also kind of complicates things just a little bit, because we've kind of, the historiography tells us that most of the core work on slavery is happening in the 19th century.
Right. So you are a scholar that's been working on this for over a decade. And
yes.
I'd love to hear a little bit, when you're talking about complication of narratives, for me that suggests that there are a series of narratives that are told about U.S. chattel slavery
yeah.
that actually don't necessarily map on to what the reality was. What yeah. are some of the major narratives that you're trying to destabilize or complicate in your work?
Yeah, so in my own work, one of the things that I do is I think about region a lot. So when you think about, you know, the rise of the carceral system, most people will say, well, you know, we're going to start post 1865 with the convict lease system. And in my own work, one of the things that I do is actually ask us to conceptualize geography. That it's true if you say like most Black people are not really in prisons pre-1865, if they're in Alabama or Georgia or, you know, Tennessee, you know, Mississippi. But when you actually look at the Upper South, when you look at Maryland, when you look at places in Virginia, you see that there's this huge, you know, a pretty large population of free people and enslaved people. And in these port cities, they're navigating not only enslavement, but they're also navigating different carceral systems, whether that is the rise of the penitentiary, the slave jail, whether that's also places like the almshouse, which is like the poorhouse. And you get to see those things happening. And, you know, when you just go up a little bit. And I think when it comes to the Royall House, one of the interesting things that we do too is to think about what does it mean? What does slavery look like, you know, in the 18th century? What does the revolutionary era actually look like? And, you know, there's a misconception that, you know, a lot of enslaved people are on big plantations. That's actually not true. Most people are on, you know, in smaller households. And that's very true when you come to the North as well. And so our site is interesting because, you know, it's a 1700s, it's a 500 acre estate. And we know that there are at least 60 people enslaved by the royal family throughout the course kind of their history in Medford. But what we're also trying to figure out is more about the lives of those enslaved people beyond just, you know, that they were enslaved. And we have a really interesting way that we do that, which is through the history of Belinda Sutton, who was enslaved by the royals and then ultimately was freed and then petitioned the Massachusetts legislature for a pension. And that's one of the earliest.
Oh, wow. What year did she petition for a pension?
She petitioned in 1783, which is significant, right?
Yeah.
Because we hear about a lot of Black women in particular, enslaved and free Black women using the courts to their benefit, right? To kind of challenge enslavement and challenge injustice. And at our site, we have someone doing that in the revolutionary era, right? So kind of pushing that back, especially from like a 19th century understanding and showing that, you know, this has been happening. And also Black women are at the center of, you know, asking, you know, using the courts to define freedom and pushing back against enslavement and asking, what does freedom mean if we are not free?
Right. And that also challenges the narrative that's often told in the U.S. that it was Abraham Lincoln and it was all these white people who we can thank for the end of slavery.
Yeah.
But actually, there's so many Black people, Black women, Black queer people who had silent acts of protest that
yes.
have just been invisibilized from the archive.
Exactly.
So you're one of the first people in my life, like a decade ago, who used the word archive to me, just like in conversation. And since then, I have so many feelings about the archive too, so I want to talk to you about it. You know, one of the things that a lot of scholars of slavery struggle through is that oftentimes the archive is overdetermined by courts and is mm-hmm. overdetermined by white people who were owners and oppressors,
yes.
and their narrative gets foregrounded because the kinds of oral culture or material culture of enslaved peoples often gets lost or absented from the archive.
Mm-hmm.
Can you speak a little bit about the stakes of doing history work with enslaved peoples, and what kind of methods do you have to use to make sure that you're not recentering dominant narratives and in fact centering the people who need to be regarded?
Yeah, that's an amazing question. I think one of the things that, you know, we have to do, I'm laughing because I remember saying archive so much that summer. But I, at the time, was thinking about how can I do this work when I know so little about the people I want to study? And I used to think that was a challenge, right? A challenge in a negative way, like, oh, I can't do this work. But there have been so many amazing scholars, right? Marissa Fuentes, Sadia Hartman, who are actually like teaching us that part of the work that we have to do is read against the grain, right? So on our site, one of the things that we do is that we did an archaeological dig a few years ago. And what we uncovered were different toy pieces that were fashioned out of tile. And so we can look at that and say, you know, enslaved people were always creating lives for themselves. You know, they were finding moments of leisure, finding moments of resistance. And we can take these different artifacts and use that to talk about enslaved resistance, right? And I think that there are moments like that are so crucial because it does, you know, tell us more than violence and violation. Mm-hmm. And it's not to say that, you know, talking about violence and violation is inherently wrong, but it's also important to show how enslaved people, you know, despite, you know, that violence and violation, we're always pushing back in small ways and in also very large ways. But if we don't know how many people, you know, absconded or ran away, that doesn't necessarily mean that people were not doing things, you know, in their own space to protect themselves and their families and also to have, you know, privacy or to push back, you know? And so I just feel very grateful to kind of have a lot of great Black feminist literature that taught me how to look for moments of resistance without romanticizing that resistance as well, you know, which is also important. We don't want to say, well, you know, well, look, these tile pieces mean that, you know, enslaved people, you know, weren't treated poorly. No, that's not what we're saying. What we're saying is that we want to complicate, you know, this conversation of violence and violation to say how were enslaved people making lives for themselves in the midst of slavery, right? How were people fighting for freedom during the height of slavery and then their everyday lives? How can we get to the interiority of enslaved people without necessarily making violence the cornerstone of their history? And I think another way that I've also learned to do that is, you know, looking at records. You're right, court records, you know, white enslaver records overdetermine the archive, but there are always these interesting moments where you can kind of read against those. So for us with Belinda Sutton, you know, you have these court records, but actually you see that she's petitioning the legislature and saying, not only am I free, but I want a pension because I, you know, worked and labored for this family and I deserve this money to take care of myself and my family. But also when she doesn't get all of her payments, she pushes back and she applies again 5 more times, you know, in a course of a decade. And so for me, that's really important. It's really rare to have, you know, documents like that. And so I really treasure it. And as a historian, I'm like, oh my gosh, this is amazing. Everyone needs to know this. Because it is a way to create a long genealogy of how enslaved people and free people kind of use the courts to manipulate, you know, not manipulate, but use the courts to kind of take a stance against slavery and injustice and to say, we're going on the record and challenging what freedom means. And if Black people are not free, then you have to think about, you know, citizenship and freedom, even if, you know, no one does anything about it in this moment.
Right. For those of you who are just tuning in, I'm speaking with Kyera Singleton, who's an amazing Black feminist historian and the executive director of the Royall House, which is a museum in Boston that also is the last remaining slave quarters in New England. And we're fundraising for their work right now to preserve those quarters. For the sake of history, we'll get into that a little bit more. The link to the GoFundMe is in my link in bio and also in the link in bio of the Royall House. So Kyera, as you're speaking, I'm thinking a lot about this term that circulates around called public history.
Yeah.
And that kind of feels like an oxymoron from the vantage point that you're giving, because the history you're doing is already public. It doesn't have the luxury or the privilege to be separate from the public, because you have to use the public and work with the public to actually animate it. I'd love to hear about your thoughts about how so often what I hear and encounter from people who have been oppressed through various histories of colonization and conquest and enslavement is that they often only find out about their histories in the university system, mm-hmm. where it's often written and largely inaccessible theoretical text, and that museums, I think, fill this really special place and culture to actually expose people to histories that have been dispossessed. So I'd love to hear, I guess it's a two-part question, your thoughts on public history, and then also your thoughts on the obligation of a museum, especially in a time like now.
Yeah. So I think what's really interesting about, you know, public history is that what you're saying about, you know, the academy and its relationship is, you know, what publics are we talking to? Which publics are we engaging, right? Because there's often a way where public history is very much so tied to an academic framework, which is fine in many regards, and it has its tools, right? But it's about how do you then move outside of that to reach different communities? And I think one of the things that we're thinking about at the Royal House and have been doing is, you know, really working with communities, working with scholars to kind of teach this history of enslavement in a way that makes people feel as though they have purchase in this history as well, right? That they have a say in what their communities also look like, right? If you have this museum that's in someone's community and we can't reach them, then that becomes an issue. And so some of the things that we do is, you know, we subsidize school programs so that the museum is accessible. We work with different artists in our community so that we're reaching different publics and talking about these different issues of enslavement, and then we connect it to the legacies of enslavement today. And I think that for me, it's really, really important that museums are, you know, seen as, you know, a way for people to process and reckon with this moment, right? That it's not enough to talk about history in the 18th century or the 19th century context and then have people go through your museum and feel as though, well, I know that happened. I educated myself. I feel good, you know? It's also to, you know, get that education, but then also say, well, wait, what are the legacies of enslavement today? How does you know, mass incarceration, health disparities, educational disparities, income disparities, you know, environmental racism impact, you know, Black communities and communities of color throughout the United States? And I think that work is really essential. And what we can do as a museum is help people reckon with that moment, right? So why is police violence like a problem? Why are these freedom movements happening? Well, it's, you know, occurring because a systemic racism, but this has a long history, right? And I think that's where we come in, and that's where our unique, you know, role is really to help people reckon with this moment and to make our space a space in which community members can look to it for that type of education, but also to help lead us in that education, because we're not necessarily in everyone's neighborhoods, right? We can be far removed. What's happening in Medford is not the same as what's happening in Roxbury, which is another area of, you know, Boston. It's not the same thing that's happening in Dorchester. And so we want to work with communities to amplify their history and then do the historical work to talk about why, you know, it's important to understand enslavement with our current moment. And I think another way that happens coming up is with all of the Confederate monuments, right? People are trying to reckon with, you know, what does their built environment look like, and how do we get to control, you know, what is considered history versus what is history that can be celebrated, and also history that is racist and needs to be, you know, dealt with accordingly.
Right. There's so much there, but I want to hone in a little bit on what the GoFundMe is actually fundraising right now, and maybe let people know about the physical site and why it's so important that we make sure that this is maintained.
Yeah. So, the slave quarters is the only known freestanding slave quarters in the Northeast. And what's really important about our site is that is such a luxury to have. You know, in many ways, we talk about not knowing as much as we want to know about the history of enslaved people, and to have a space in which we know enslaved people lived, they worked, they resisted, you know, they encountered violence. It's really important because we often just don't have that, you know, know, that knowledge. We don't have those physical spaces, especially in the North. There's some in the South for sure, but not in the North as much. And to have that, to have this site and to make this site the cornerstone of our museum and of our education, I think allows people to really kind of reckon with the legacies of slavery in their own communities, right? And to preserve it is, for me, a part of, you know, preserving Black history, which is American history, right? Mm-hmm. Is we're not trying to hide this space. We're not trying to, you know, pretend that it's not there. We're trying to say, look, this space is here. It's going to be, you know, used to educate about slavery. And on top of that, it is a place where we memorialize the lives of enslaved people, where we memorialize Black history, where we memorialize, you know, the lives of the people who were forced to labor for this family. And that is important. You know, it is important to have a space where you walk in to the slave quarters. There's a panel that has a list of the 60 people that we know about who were enslaved on the, you know, by the royals. And so that's one of the first things you see when you actually walk into the slave quarters. So, you know, we're not shying away from the history. We're not, you know, romanticizing the history. It's a hard history, but one that is essential to, I think, to, you know, moving us forward in a social justice conversation, is that if we can't reckon with the past, how can we possibly reckon with our current moment? And so it's really important that we preserve these slave quarters so that people know that it existed. It existed in Medford. It existed all throughout the North, but that this is a museum that centers the lives of the enslaved people to tell this history about slavery. The royal family is really important because this is how we know, you know, they, you know, the space, the museum is so, you know, lavish because of enslavement, and that it's a physical space that was preserved. But we complicate that narrative by talking and centering the lives of the enslaved people on, you know, who were enslaved there.
You know, one of the things that I found out as we were preparing for this talk is that you're one of the few Black women executive directors of a museum in this country, and that's concerning and troublesome. And I would love to hear a little bit also about your vision going forward for this museum, and also your vision going forward for the future of cultural preservation work. Yeah. Because I know that you come with such intention to your academic work, and I'm so curious about how that lends itself into your public archiving work.
Yeah, that's a very great question. I think quite simply, one of my main visions, you know, with the museum, working in conjunction with, you know, our board of directors, is to think about how to make this history both accessible and more visible. You know, I meet people when I tell them, oh, I'm the executive director of this museum. They're like, what? I didn't even know that there were slave quarters, like, two blocks away from me, you know? And so I think that, you know, it's all about amplifying, right? Amplifying the really amazing work that we've already been doing on this site and getting it out to broader and more diverse communities. But one thing in particular for me that I'm really passionate about is making sure that, you know, young kids who look like me get to come to this museum, you know, Black kids, kids of color in general get to come through this museum. And as they're learning about this museum, that they, you know, they're learning about it in a way that doesn't make them feel as though they can't engage with slavery because it's too painful, right? It's a way to, you know, talk about this painful history as a way to say, like, this happened in the past, provides us, you know, a blueprint to ask different questions for the future. And that not only do we care about this history, but we care about you and how you're treated in this current moment. And so I really think accessibility, making it visible, right? Reaching broader audiences, increasing our social media output, really thinking about how we tell the story of enslaved people and doing more research. You know, we're in a really unique position right now where we're forming different academic partnerships, which gives us the ability to do more research about the enslaved people who, you know, who were once enslaved by the royal family. And what that does is that it really does center the enslaved people, because we're trying to find out even more information than what we already know. And as a historian, if we find one sentence that lets us know about one other person, that is a win for me, because we're trying to recoup the lives that have been thought to be lost. And until we can get into the archive, we actually don't know, you know, how much we can actually track about the enslaved people. But I'm so excited to try and to work with this amazing group of people who are also dedicated to doing the same work. And once we get that, I think we kind of really push it to the center and say that, like, you know, the vision is that when someone hears our name, the Royall House and Slave Quarters, they know that we're a museum that memorializes the lives of enslaved people, you know, and that we're doing the hard work.
Thank you so much for that work. I have one final question, and if other people have questions, please in the question section at the bottom, type in your questions there and I'll get to some of them. So I suppose for my final question right now, you know, you and I have spoken at length in the past about the importance of culture. And I think in this moment right now, a lot of people are coming up with a definition of resistance that often doesn't include culture. And we've sort of spoken at, tease this out a little bit in this conversation, but I'd love to hear a little bit more just explicitly. Why do you think it's important to mobilize culture, especially as part of this global protest and uprising that's happening right now? And once again, for people who are watching, put your questions at the bottom and I'll get to some of them to ask Kyera.
Yeah, I think, you know, when I think about the role of culture and the role of museums, what's really important is that, you know, I think sometimes we divorce kind of social movements from cultural movements, right? And so it's really, you know, we can talk about the different protests, we can talk about, you know, how people are trying to change their communities on the ground. And one of the ways that I see that happening is also through museum work, right? And through the preservation and amplification of Black history, of the history of slavery, right? Of actually thinking about preserving these spaces that tell a story that we can then talk about these larger movements, resistance movements and protest movements, but also that museums in particular can be a space where, you know, we process these hard conversations and we can help our communities heal, you know, we can help through talking about history, through talking about this work, through saying that this is an important part of American history and it's about the culture of, you know, the culture of racism, the culture of violence, right? The culture of preservation work can push back against these narratives that say that, like, these histories do not matter or these histories can remain hidden because it's not as important as something else. And so I think for me, very, very explicitly, I see the role of museums as being, you know, spaces in which communities can work together to learn about this history and be a healing space, right? To come in to do this hard work, to talk about this history and say, not only does this matter on a local level, a regional level, but a national level, right? And I see the Royall House and Slave Quarters as a part of that conversation. We want to help our communities reckon with the past. We want to help our communities reckon with this moment. And I think as a museum, we can do that through our artifacts, through our educational programs, literally through the actual buildings that exist, right? To show people this is the legacy of enslavement in this country right now, right? A part of the legacy of enslavement in this country. And we have to reckon with it in the same way that we have to reckon with police violence. They're all connected.
Thank you. So our first question is, someone said, I love that you use the word enslaved people instead of slaves. Are schools teaching this word?
Are schools teaching this word?
Yeah.
So I don't know kind of how all schools are dealing with the language between slave or enslaved, but I know very much so for me and how I've learned is that when you think about when you're talking about enslaved people, you have to use enslaved because slave is not a natural condition, right? Like, you know, people aren't born slaves. And so people are enslaved. And I really hope that a lot of schools are using that language. But one of the goals of the Royall House is when we do school programs and we work with teachers, Kyeras, we're very particular about our language. And so that language, when we're working with school groups, is the language that, you know, children are hearing. And that's really important, because I think it makes the space a space that can also be empowering, as opposed to, you know, really debilitating, especially if you have Black kids and students of color hearing, you know, people being referred to as slaves.
Thank you. Next question. What kind of programming do you dream about for the future of the museum?
Oh, I dream about so much programming. I dream about a lot of programming. So some of the programming that I've been working on and dreaming about, I would love ultimately to do a teach-in about mass incarceration and the roots of enslavement and how they work together. So that's one thing that I've been dreaming about and hoping to make happen over the course of the year. Earlier this summer, I worked on a poetry as protest event, which was bringing in a poet, Malcolm Tariq, to do a reading and talking about how poetry and social justice can help us work through difficult conversations. And we're looking to expand that. And so my dream would be to constantly bring in different poets that are in New England, but also nationally, to talk about the history of enslavement, but also who talk about the modern manifestations of enslavement through their work. So that's some of the programming I've been working on and dreaming about. Some of the other things that I would love to happen is that there have been a lot of people who've talked about Belinda Sutton, the woman I mentioned earlier at our site, and I would love to have a conversation with them and have them come and talk about what it meant to find this history, and then also kind of make it, you know, write about it for a popular audience. So those are some of the things that I've been just thinking about and wanting to work on.
Well, thank you so much, Kyera. A couple of action items before we close. So we are so close to getting $20,000 to ensure that Royall House is able to maintain their work and their site. And we talked a little bit before about the significance of the date 1908. Can you tell people about 1908? Because we're asking folks if you can donate $19 to preserve this historical site or more, and let's help them reach 20K.
Yeah, so 1908 is when the museum actually became a museum. So that's the significance of the 1908 date. And Alok and I thought it was a cool way to have a number that people could hold on to and have purchase with.
Awesome. And please follow the Royall House on Instagram. I'm going to tag them in this caption when I post. And go to our bios, where we both have links to this GoFundMe. If you're in the Boston area, check out about the amazing programming that they're going to be doing over the next few months. And let's all make sure to support Kyera. I think it's so powerful and important that you're one of the few Black women holding it down in this space and in museum culture more generally. On behalf of everyone tuning in, like, we're so grateful for your leadership, for your intention, for your deliberate, resistant work to make these histories accessible and insist on a counter narrative. So much of what's happening in this world right now is an erasure of the legacies and the histories of this country. And it's so important that we recognize that sites like this are physical, material critiques of these narratives that the government is circulating that invisibilize the origins of this country. If people want to get involved with the museum, is there a way that they should best reach out?
Yes. So one of the ways that you can get involved, if you go to our website, royallhouse.org. There is a join, so you can become a member, which is one of the best ways that you can learn about everything that's going on. But you can also join our mailing list and stay up to date about what we're doing. If you want to volunteer, you can also reach out to programs@royallhouse.org. And that's also another way that you can get in touch with me and other people. And then we will connect you with who you need to be connected with and kind of, you know, let you know what we're doing and how you can get involved.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. Apparently we're at like 16.5K now, so we're so close. I'm going to post this on my feed if people want to share it afterwards so that we can continue to fundraise. Thank you.
Thank you, Alok. This was great.
Of course. Talk to you later.
Okay, bye.
Bye.